Okay, so let's start with the webinar. So good morning again. My name is Tomasz Zwolenski, and I'm a product manager with RF Elements. And today we'll be looking a lot closer at what coverage actually means. And if any time during the webinar you have any questions, feel free, or actually I would encourage you to write them down into the webinar tool questions section, and I will answer them at the end of the webinar. So let's start. So at RF Elements, we provide innovative solutions for a modern day WISP. Still today, the biggest problem of unlicensed WISP networks is interference caused by using gear that is either poorly designed and deployed without any regard to sustainability, which is connected to the RF noise produced by these devices. So if only a few people produce noise, it might not be a big deal, but if everyone does, then everybody will suffer sooner or later. At RF Elements, we address this problem of RF noise by changing the paradigm of fixed wireless industry. And we're setting new industry standards for RF performance, noise rejection, and system scalability through our award-winning horn antenna technology with TwistPort ecosystem. Let's go directly to the topic. So these two images show the same scenario, but the one on the left shows an overlay of antenna beamwidth on a map. So the blue area does not really represent the coverage. It simply shows you the section of a circle corresponding to the antenna beamwidth angle on the map, but nothing more really. The image on the right, on the other hand, is the closest thing to how coverage would look like if the electromagnetic waves were visible. While the electromagnetic waves do not have any color, in order to visualize something, we obviously need to use a color. Now, in this case, the more vibrant the red is, the stronger the signal is, and vice versa. The more faint it is, the weaker the signal is. And in the lower right corner, you can see the scale of the signal strength. But before we go into the details of coverage, it will be useful to debunk the misconceptions about what users may think coverage is or isn't. So let's have a look at exactly this in the following few slides. Many users understand the coverage of an area is defined by a beamwidth of an antenna, which is simply not true. They are connected to one another, but in general, they're not the same thing, actually not even close. It is important to be clear about this fact because some antenna manufacturers use beamwidth in place of coverage to give a simple answer to rather complex question, which can do more harm than benefit. The usual way to visualize coverage is to plot a pizza slice shaped area where the beamwidth angle determines the angular width of the coverage and the gain of an antenna determines how far the sector reaches. So inside this area, the conventional thinking is that inside this area, we have signal coverage and outside it, we do not. Simple and clear, isn't it? But unfortunately, this is a huge oversimplification of what coverage really is. The reality is that the various link calculators you might be using or know from your own experience might show some signal strength even if you place the CPE outside the area that is supposedly covered. Now, how can that be? I mean, something definitely doesn't add up here. So obviously there must be some sort of a mismatch between what is shown and the reality. The coverage is not a digital variable that has value 1 inside the blue area and zero everywhere else. So if the beam width does not define the coverage, what is it then? And what is it good for? Beam width is an antenna parameter. It is defined by the decrease of an antenna gain from the bore site by some value. And in WISP industry, this value is either -3 or -6 dB. Now, these numbers are based on historically accepted standard, but as such, they're arbitrary and closely tied with the maximum gain rather than anything else. And actually, it helps you to get an idea. The beam width helps you get an idea what the expected shape of the radiation pattern may be. The beam width is useful information for antenna alignment, for example. Now, with a very narrow beam width antenna, one must be precise when aligning a point-to-point link, because even small deviations can have strong effect on the link performance. And this includes the mounting of the antenna. So narrow beam width antennas should have a sturdy mounting that should be able to withstand windy conditions, because even small misalignments can throw the whole link completely off. Although generally there is no strictly point-to-point or multi-point antenna, the beam width is a good indicator what application an antenna might be better for. Just the narrow sectors are, of course, possible also using a narrow beam width antennas, but because the higher gain comes with a narrower beam width, as the physics of antennas dictate, high gain antennas are most used in point-to-point links to squeeze every possible length of distance from a link. In antenna textbooks, you can find that the -3 dB beam width angle marks so-called crossover point of two sectors, which is a point where the coverage areas of the two sectors need to overlap to ensure proper functioning of a network. But as with any textbook parameter, it depends on the type of application if it's useful. And for WISP industry, the usefulness of the sector crossover point is really negligible due to the unregulated nature of WISP networks in inline SIST bands. So we've shown you a short teaser in the beginning, in the first few slides, and now that we know that the beam width is just a very crude and inaccurate measure of what coverage is, let's have a look at what it really is. There are many parameters that go into visualizing coverage. First, the site, it has certain height above the ground, radio has an output power, the antenna has specific radiation pattern and down tilt. Then we need the map data to have enough precision and the information how the access point is oriented in this map. Knowing all these parameters, we can project the fields radiated from the antenna onto the map surface. And this is what coverage really is. It's a projection of the fields radiated from an antenna, including all those parameters on a map surface. Yeah, it's a visualization of the signal strength on a map. Now you can see that there is no limit to where you can have coverage or not. It shows you how the signal strength changes with distance. And it has a continuous and smooth decay until the signal strength is below your radio noise floor, which obviously sets a definite limit to the distance until which it makes sense to display the coverage at all. And the precision of the coverage calculation is limited by the precision of all these input variables. So there are some factors which are, of course, difficult to count in, like, for example, the changing weather or changing foliage of the trees with the changing season. But that's something obviously to consider when using tools that actually do plot the coverage. A good example of coverage visualization is provided by visible light, which is also an electromagnetic wave, just like the 5 GHz RF signal, except at much higher frequencies. So the circular spotlight on the ground, which the light is pointed at, is the coverage itself. And the flashlight in this case can be compared to an antenna. So, but except the visible light, the electromagnetic waves are invisible, which makes the visualization of the coverage using RF signal, using the RF signal, more obscure. What we can do though is to visualize the RF coverage using a pseudocolor. So we assign the strongest signal a certain color, in this case red, and the weaker the signal gets, the more transparent it is. So in this example, we show the coverage when using 38 degree symmetrical horn. So the dashed lines you can see indicate the 30 degree beamwidth as minus 6 dB. And by now, I'm sure it's clear to you why the signal reaches beyond these lines. The coverage is a measure of the whole 3D, three-dimensional radiation pattern and all the other variables mentioned earlier. So you can see that there is no clear border between the area with and the area without the signal. It is a continuous and smooth function of the radiation pattern. For human eye, the single color with degrees of transparency is actually not the easiest thing to work with in practice, because it is hard to tell the signal strength at any point. But to make this plot more useful in practical life, we can actually use more than just one color. So if we're already using one, why not to use more? So the same plot when using five colors instead of just one looks like this. Now it's much clearer and easier to say where the signal is, let's say minus 17 dBm, which corresponds to the bright green color, or let's say minus 45 dBm, close to the red part of the coverage. The color helps our eyes to quickly estimate what signal strength can be expected and where. But we can actually go even further. So if on top of the AP output power and the CPE gain, we also know what the channel width is and what is the noise floor in an area, or at least have an estimate, we can still improve the practical usability of this plot. So these are the MCS rate ISO surfaces. Here, each color determines the span of MCS rates the link can work with. This plot gives you immediate visual information with very clear borders, because the edges are very sharp on what the MCS rate you can expect depending on the location of the customer. So now you understand all those cases when you were setting up a link and wondered how come you can see the access point which you should not have seen based on the beamwidth of an antenna you used. It is clear now that using the beamwidth as a coverage approximation is really inaccurate and misleading. It's important to understand that all antennas actually work in a similar fashion. So the coverage is basically these elliptically shaped areas, as the one shown in this image, but of course differing depending on the shape of the radiation pattern. So going further, we prepared a few examples of commonly used antennas in WISP industry to illustrate how the coverage looks based on the real physics-based data and simulation. So let's start with sector antennas. The traditional sector antenna has a wide radiation pattern, and unsurprisingly, the coverage is not determined by the beamwidth. You can also see the back radiation and the side lobes that cause all the issues with collocation of these antennas very clearly. In hope of mitigating the collocation issues, many WISPs turn to all kinds of shields installed to the back of these antennas. And while the shield might dampen the back radiation a little bit, you see what it does to the rest of the radiation pattern. Now its shape is rather wild, potentially making your life actually more difficult, because especially the customers who were close to the edges of the sector can now find themselves out of it. So the shields are not a good idea when trying to deal with the noise, because for example, in this case, we can see that the back radiation did not really change much and the main lobe has changed substantially. which is undesired. Our symmetrical horns have no side lobes, which is clearly seen from this plot. Just a nice pill-shaped beam pointing forward. And let me emphasize again, just to make it really, really clear, that these images are not created in Photoshop by some graphics guy, but they're real physics-based simulations, which is the closest thing to reality you can get. Same goes for asymmetrical horns. Here, the coverage is shown. The coverage shown for the 90-degree asymmetrical RF elements horn. And again, any antenna would give similar result in terms of that there are multiple MCO zone within the beamwidth angle, and the signal goes also beyond this angle as well. Similar images can be produced for point-to-point antennas, which will show even more obviously that the coverage is much more than beamwidth alone. Among all directional antennas, dish is the most common one used in WISP industry. Here you can see how the coverage looks like using this particular dish. Now, besides the substantial differences between the polarizations in terms of the side lobes and undesired coverage as a result of them, you can see that there is a lot happening outside the declared 5 degrees beamwidth, which again is highlighted by the dashed white lines. And further confirming that the coverage of an antenna provides goes way beyond the beamwidth definition. Looking at the real coverage plots, more can be said about pretty much any antenna. And it's really the ultimate indicator of what the coverage is. In this case, the directional patch array side lobes are very clear, as well as the chain misbalance. Each of the polarizations has quite different coverage shape. Optimized design of RF elements ultra dish antenna really helps minimize the side lobes to a large degree, but unfortunately, the physics of the dish antennas dictate that the side lobes are very hard to avoid completely. Nevertheless, our ultra dish is optimized for minimizing the side lobes. And here's ultra horn. So no side lobes whatsoever, just a single beam and that's it. It behaves in a similar manner as the flashlight example we've shown before, providing a very clean coverage with no side lobes, creating unwanted coverage areas. Moreover, its performance is identical in both polarizations, which is why there is only one plot. So the coverage is really identical for horizontal and vertical polarization, which is the case with the symmetrical horns in general. So the plots on the previous slides are showing only a static image of the coverage at one single frequency point. Now, if we calculate the coverage at many frequency points and make it into an animation, we can see how the coverage changes with frequency. And this is a very important factor for an information for WISPs, since you use a wide chunk of the spectrum. So therefore, an antenna performance, and in this case, we mean the coverage, should be ideally stable over the whole bandwidth, because a stable coverage means a reliable tool and also a reliable service to your end customers eventually. So seeing this animation might not surprise you, because you may have experienced in practice that where by switching channels, you know, hoping to use the cleaner bit of the spectrum, the results might have been even worse, leaving you really like scratching your head, like what's going on here? Like I see in the cleaner bit of the spectrum, and when I switch to the channel, well, the performance is even worse. Now, this is exactly what happens when you're changing the channels. The radiation pattern is changing a lot with frequency, causing the fluctuations and ultimately unreliability of the network. And this is the unfortunate property of the patch array sectors in general. And not only sectors, like any antenna based on the patch array technology. And this is what we mean when we say that the coverage is not stable or reliable. The frequency dependence of the radiation pattern makes the user experience anything but satisfying, and your life as a WISP constantly busy servicing the links that change whenever you switch channels. This is how RF elements patch array sector performs. The coverage fluctuates somewhat, as you can see, but overall, it is much more stable than with most antennas of comparable type. Now, visualizing the coverage like this really tells the story of what a stable coverage should look like. And even more so with our horn antennas. If our patch array sector was stable, horns are super stable within the spectrum, and the coverage is virtually unchanging, which is what you want from any sector or directional antenna for that matter. This way you can rely on its performance and provide the headache-free service to your customers, which is a dream of every WISP out there. Symmetrical horn is a very different case from anything else. It provides extremely stable coverage within the legal spectrum. This is the great advantage of horns as a type of antennas, their stability. But do not get fooled. I mean, not all the horns are that stable by default. The horn can be designed to achieve such coverage stability, but it still takes a considerable effort to achieve. Down tilt is another functionality of RF elements horns, unlike any patch array antenna. And from the following slides, we will see why. The down tilt is a huge factor influencing the coverage area when it comes regarding the patch array sectors or any other antenna with a very narrow radiation pattern in the elevation plane. From this animation, you can see that anything beyond a few degrees of down tilt makes the patch array practically useless. Or in other words, you lose the coverage almost completely. This is the disadvantage of a very narrow radiation pattern in the elevation plane and why the sectors require very precise setup of the down tilt and why they're so sensitive to even small deviations. Which also actually makes them poor sector antennas when in really very mountainous or hilly regions, yeah, that elevation narrow radiation pattern is simply not able to cover those valleys well. Asymmetrical horns have a strong advantage of gradual shrinking of the coverage with increasing down tilt, while retaining the shape of the covered area. And so this smooth coverage area shrinking when increasing the gain from 0 to 25 degrees, I mean the down tilt from 0 to 25 degrees, is yet another tool or additional functionality in your hands, which can help you mitigate the noise your radio sees and respond to changing customer base depending on where the furthest customer is located. With symmetrical horns, the effect of down tilt is also a totally different game compared to patch array sectors. Progressively increasing the down tilt, you can see just the gradual smooth shrinking of the coverage area while its shape is completely preserved. So this is yet another advantage of the symmetrical horns. By using the down tilt, you can dynamically improve the noise conditions in your network by setting the down tilt based on the furthest customer throughput requirements. So this way, the antenna only delivers and receives the signal as far as necessary. Here you can see an example of how to use the down tilt. If your customers are clustered closer to the site, and the competitor ones are further, you simply set the down tilt such that the MCS zone you want to provide to your customers covers only your own CPEs. Now, this will help avoid the interference from other CPEs in the area as much as possible. And actually, this principle is valid in general, regardless where the competitive CPEs or any other links might be located. Simply set the down tilt according to your CPE that is the furthest in the particular sector. And if you're wondering how to figure out the down tilt, you need to use to leverage this feature. Our link calculator 2.0 is the right tool for exactly that, because it plots the MCS zones directly on the map. So let's have a look at it right now. I will show you how the new link calculator works and give you a little demo on how to use it and how to arrive at that correct down tilt. So let me switch to the link calculator. So if you haven't used it before, you can access the link calculator from our landing page, rfelements.com. And there's a big tile right now, or you can access it from the menu on the bottom, clicking on the in the support column, clicking on the link calculator. And this will bring you the button on the bottom will bring you to the previous version, yeah, to the old version of the link calculator. So to see the new features, you have to click this big red button which is shining at you at the top of the map. So doing that will get to the calculator. I mean, if you used it or not, depending on that, you might have or not seen the video. So when I clicked the try new features button, if this was my first visit to the site, it would automatically show a video playing with the release notes of the new calculator. And know that you have to, you know, when you watch the whole video until the end, after that, the pop-up window will disappear and you'll land exactly where I am now. So let me highlight the main differences. I'll fly through all the features quickly and highlight the differences compared to the previous version. So you can, you know, edit the location by simply drag and drop any of the AP or CPE, or put an address or GPS coordinates, whatever you prefer. And actually, it's also quite useful to use the satellite view when you're fine tuning the placement of either CPE or the AP, where you can see all the roofs and place the CPE quite accurately. And right, so let's go to the AP settings. You can select any of our antennas, which was already there before, but then we also added the sector carrier class 520 because many of our customers still use this antenna. A major change is that you can now select the channel width, which helps increase the accuracy of the results that the calculator shows. The gain of the AP antenna is set based on the choice of the antenna from the drop-down menu, and you can edit the output power. And here you see the sum of the output power and the gain, showing you the EIRP, so you can stay within the legal limits. The height of the antenna is actually is the height above the ground. So if an antenna or the AP is on a building, so you have to add the height of the building to the height of the tower on which it is attached and put it here for more precision. And then you can play with the down tilt as well. So the CPE settings and results. A major change from the previous version is that now you can select from the list of CPEs of the major manufacturers. And in case you do not find the CPE you're using, which might happen with the Ubiquiti CPEs because Ubiquiti did not cooperate with us and didn't provide us all the data that we need to include these devices into our calculator. So you might find yourself that you didn't find the CPE you were looking for. And for cases like that, you should choose either the generic 802.11ac or N radio. which is there for all those cases. So some radios do not have an integrated antenna. Now in that case, you can just edit the gain of the CPE depending on what antenna you're using. Well, some of the CPEs though have an integrated antenna, in which case you of course cannot edit the gain. And if you have an information about what the noise floor is in the area, again, it's good to punch those numbers in because it will increase the precision of the calculation or the estimate of the results. And the height of the CPE is similar. So you should enter the height of the building plus the tower if the CPE is on a building. The results you're interested in are now highlighted. So the received power and the link quality are now highlighted. And this is just the link distance. The elevation profile graph did not change much. The AP is on the left side and the CPE is on the right side. And it shows you the line of sight and what the terrain profile is between them, which is good for the cases when there is no line of sight. For example, now we can see that we're on a hill, and when I move the AP even further, we can see that link is obstructed, and which is yet another indicator telling you, or you know, making it clear why you have no results in the results section. A bigger change also happened in the received power graph. So now the y-axis is still the received power in the dBm, but the color coding of the graph shows you between what distances you can have a given MCS rate. So we can see that now the CPE location is indicated by the vertical blue line. And we can see that we can work with MCS 9 up till somewhere around 11.4 kilometers. Which is a good information if you know for you to know, and which is also actually, by the way, shown in the link details. It's 11 and a half, where this information tells you the maximum range at the MCS you're currently at. Then you have an option to change the frequency at which the link is working. And despite that, our antennas are very stable with changing frequency, as we've seen, it's always good to punch that number in depending on what channel you use, simply again to improve the accuracy as much as possible. Other than that, when you're done with setting up your link, you can download your results into a PDF for a future reference. And if you're not sure about anything, then we have the guide video, full tutorial video about the link calculator. So now let's switch to the multi. This was single CPE version. Let's now go to the multi CPE version. As advertised, now the calculator shows you the MCS zones directly in the map. So the pulsating blue area tells you that the calculation is in progress. And now we can see the result when we're using the symmetrical horn with 30 degrees beam width. And I'm not going to go through the settings because they're exactly the same as in the single CPE version. The main difference here being that now it's very easy to see as I move the CPE into the yellow zone, I have the link quality based on the color coding. So it's very quick and easy reference. And while the highest MCS rates might be the most interesting ones, you can turn on and off any of the MCS zones, which is quite a nice feature. It makes it more interactive. And if you helps you also to pinpoint or focus on one thing if you want to. Yeah. So if you're fine providing your customers the service with the link quality of MCS 8, you just turn on that particular MCS zone plot. And now you see exactly where the borders of the sector are. So a few more upgrades here. So previously, when you wanted to add more CPEs, you would have to use this button down here below below the CPEs, yeah, which you can. But then there is an additional button directly in the map, which makes it a lot more easier and user-friendly, because if you have more CPEs and still want to add more, you would have to scroll all the way down, which can be quite annoying. And actually the same goes for the results. Yeah, so they're below each CPE settings part, but also there is a results table directly in the map again, that you don't have to scroll all the way down to see how that particular link performs. Another important thing to realize or to be aware of is that the coverage shown is always valid for the CPE just selected. So, which is you can recognize it by having inverted colors compared to the rest of the CPEs. So currently we have selected the CPE number one. So here on the bottom of the map, it says for which CPE the coverage is valid. So now as I select different CPEs, we see that the coverage is not really changing. And this is because they're actually the same devices. Yeah. So the CPE one is the same as the CPE three or the CPE four, and all of their parameters, including the noise floor and the height above the ground, are the same. So naturally the coverage will be the same. Now when I select the CPE number two, which is a different device having lower gain, the coverage will start recalculating again. And that's just because of that. It's a different device, or even if I changed any height of the CPE 1, 3, or 4, it would also change the coverage. Not substantially, but it still would. The difference is most visible when the CPE is a different device. And now we can see that, okay, let me turn on more MCS zones, that according to the table, the CPE 2 works at MCS 7, which now corresponds to the displayed coverage. The CPE 2 is in the yellow zone. But looking at the rest of them, we can see that, well, CPE 3, 4 should also have MCS 7, right? But they do have MCS 9. And that's, again, just another indicator of or a cue for you as a user to be aware and always look what CPE is the coverage displayed for. So when I switch back, we'll see that, okay, now it fits, that the CPE 3 and 4 are in the red zone, and the CPE 1, well, is at the edge, but still it's already in the orange zone. Okay, so now let's see how can we figure out that down tilt. So let's say these are our CPEs, and regardless what is surrounding us, we want to minimize the noise that the AP actually sees. And we can, let's say that we're good with providing the MCS number 8 to all the customers. So I just increase the down tilt of the AP, let's say randomly to 13 degrees, and we wait a little bit to see what the resulting coverage will be like. And now we see that, okay, the coverage has shrunk naturally as we increase the down tilt. Actually, let me just change this to the same CPE so that we're on the same page. So, and we see that, okay, all the CPEs still have MCS 9, and we see that the gap coverage goes still beyond our cluster of customers. And it doesn't matter, they don't even have to be close to each other, right? It can be, again, as I said during the presentation, you want to set the down tilt based on the furthest customer MCS requirements in that given sector. So let's say that's the CPE number 2, and it still works at MCS 9, so we can still go further down with the down tilt. So we added a few degrees and wait for the result. And we see that, okay, that's pretty fine, I would say. I mean, the MCS of the CPE number 2 is 8, which is what we're shooting for. The rest of them have MCS 9, which is great because even better, right? But you definitely don't want to push the down tilt too far to the edge. So the ideal down tilt in this scenario would be around 17 degrees, maybe 16, 15, you know, if you just want to be safe. And all our antennas actually have the scale of the down tilt on the bracket, so it's easy to actually see what the down tilt is when you're trying to set it up. Maybe 16 degrees would be just the sweet spot. Let's see. Yeah, that looks good to me. So, and then anything, of course, there can be CPEs anywhere within your zone too, but again, it's really just about, you know, you can only optimize the coverage for your own CPEs, you know, not the competitive ones or any other. Another thing that is good at the new calculator is that you can use the full screen mode by clicking this icon here in the right upper corner of the map, which makes it more user friendly. So the whole menu of the AP settings and the CPE settings with the results is included there. So, you know, it makes it more user friendly to work in this full screen mode if you want to. And actually, you can also remove the CPEs from the map if you, you know, accidentally put more than you wanted. Just by pressing this X next to the CPE, the CPE will be removed. Okay, so let's go back to the presentation. Right. So here is a QR code, which is a shortcut to our new link calculator. And just one more thing about the link calculator is that we provide this tool for you for free. So, and the data, the map data we're using for the calculation of the coverage is also free. So please take it as it is and have the patience, because the map data has limited accuracy, especially around water bodies. So when you're around a lake or a river, the accuracy of the coverage calculation may be lower there. And after all, in the link calculator, we also have a feedback button. So if you have any suggestions or are really unhappy with something, just let us know, and we'll try to incorporate your comments in the next iteration. So it is important to have high performance hardware, and at the same time, it is important to have the understanding of how to use it correctly and how it works, which is why user education is an important part of our activities. Now, it is one of our many first time in the WISP industry things that we at RF Elements can put on display. Now, our idea is that only an educated customer can make qualified decisions. So we're also very open about myth busting, and because there are many myths and misconceptions in the wireless industry that can create big problems to many users. We have an online community, rfelab.com, which is a user forum where you can ask your questions or about our products, connect with us, get in touch, or just search through the questions that were already asked in the past. And we're also updating it with all the events we take part in. And you can also find a lot of recorded webinars, such as this one there. And we're present on all the major social media as well. So just a trademark disclaimer, the third-party trademarks are used only to reference compatibility with our RF Elements products, and all the rights of respective trademark owners are reserved.